Before I start, I again hope that you already given some time in understanding the things related to the system conversion. So in system conversion, what we discussed is five phases. It starts with preparation. Then you have installation. Then you have delta config, data migration, and last one is activities after migration, right? So these are the five phases that we have in the system conversion. Preparation means whatever activities we carry out in our current ECC system to make it ready to be upgraded to S/4HANA. Installation is a task which basis will perform in order to convert your existing system to SAP S/4HANA. Okay, so the technical tools we discussed, like maintenance planner, a custom code analyzer, we use those tools here in the installation phase. And then we have delta config. So I told you this delta config, data migration, and activities after migration, these are available here in the conversion cockpit. So if you open the conversion cockpit, there are three separate folders. This is nothing but delta configuration, this is data migration, and this is activities after migration. Okay, and in this particular thing, we already completed this first part. We discussed about preparation and migration of customizing. And within this, we discussed what is required as a delta configuration from the general ledger perspective. So just a quick overview. So we agreed that company code and controlling area, they must have the same fiscal year variant. If it is not, system will throw error, and that you can check it out here. Currency settings, which is nothing but your ledgers, which currencies are active and all, you can do it here. When you migrate the general ledger customizing, whatever configuration is available in your ledger settings in ECC, that will get copied into S/4HANA with the new values, right? So for example, the total tables are no more available. The ledgers are divided into two parts, standard and extension. So that is taken care by this and this activity. Okay, then there is a review where you can go and see which company code, which ledger is assigned to which accounting principle. So for example, if I want to see for our company code SF01, how many ledgers are we using and which ledger is representing which accounting principle, right? So this is just to check out which accounting principle is being used. We also discussed this particular thing multiple times, define ledgers for CO version, which means which ledger from FI will go and post in which CO version. Okay, similarly, document type mapping variant, default values for posting and controlling, offsetting account we discussed two times. And in the last session, we discussed this in detail, source ledger for migration of balances. So I gave you the example that if my customer was using classic GL accounting, at that time, ledger 0L was not available. So for all those years, when customer was not using the new GL functionality, he has to migrate the balance of ledger 0. Okay, so that thing we have seen in the offsetting, source ledger. And then final things, check and define settings for controlling area, which is nothing but it will open the OKKHP screen, where you can go and see which controlling areas defined, which components are active. So this is just to check out. And last one is, finally, once you perform all these configurations, you will go to execute consistency check and check whether all your configurations are consistent with each other or not. So if there is any error here in the consistency check, this means some of the activities that you have performed in the above things, they are not properly configured. The system will tell you what is wrong. You have to solve that error and then only go to the next step. Right? So these are the settings which are required from the general ledger perspective. Accrual engine, as I told you, this is the completely different functionality. We don't need to worry about this. Asset accounting, we already discussed that in S/4HANA, we have new asset accounting available. And in order to convert your data from existing asset accounting to new asset accounting, you will be using this migration programs. So migration from classic to new GL accounting, here you will be using this migration to new asset accounting and migrate chart of depreciation. Okay, so asset accounting, there is not much here. All these activities are not provided in the cockpit, you have to activate those configurations separately. So the list is given here, which is same as the list that we have used in case of new implementation. Okay, so which activities needs to be carried out, the list is provided here. Okay, and then after the asset accounting, we discussed about controlling. In controlling, there is only one thing available in the Convergent cockpit, and that is nothing but account-based COPA. So in order to activate account-based COPA, here it will allow you to maintain the operating concern and then activate the account-based COPA. Okay, so again, this we have seen. After that, material ledger we discussed. Material ledger is a mandatory functionality. So if it is not already active, you have to execute this single program, migrate material ledger customizing. Okay, and this program will show you whether the material ledger has been activated for your plant or not. So you can see for SF01, material ledger is active. You can see the green indicator. Okay, and then let's close material ledger also. We have not discussed anything related to house bank accounts. So this is the only topic that we have pending, which we are going to take on Sunday, house bank related. Trade finance is related to foreign trade functionality, which is mainly into SAP MM and SAP SD. Credit management is normally topic within SAP SD, but we already discussed about this in the last session. I told you the SD credit management, we were using transaction FD32 to enter the credit limit of the customers, which is no more available because it has been replaced with financial supply chain management. Let me just show you this particular thing once again in the server. I think last time I just gave you the overview, but I've not shown you anything in the system. So let me just. So first of all, if you try to use the old transaction, which was FD32, okay, and press enter, you will get this error. FD32 is no more available. Okay, why? Because the old functionality of SD AR credit management is no more available, and the only way in which you can configure the credit management functionality in SAP S/4HANA is using FSCM credit management. Okay, where is FSCM credit management? There is a separate folder for FSCM. You must be already aware that you have this financial supply chain management. And within financial supply chain management, there is this whole configuration is maintained here in credit management. Okay, which is mainly the integration between SD. Okay, so these all the configurations which SD was doing till now in the sales and distribution folder, it is not available anymore, and it has to be done via financial supply chain management. Okay, so normally I cover this topic in full detail in my simple logistics course, because this is mainly for those consultants who are working in SAP SD. But what I will do is I will share that video, complete video of FSCM credit management with you. So maybe you are not going to actually configure the credit management apart from creating the credit control area, but still it will help you in your project when you have the configurations also required from the SD side. Okay, so this is covered in that video in complete detail, and I'll share that video with you. Then let's go to the next one. Okay, so credit management. So in short, we are done with this first folder, which is nothing but we are done with Delta configuration part. Now we are left with two phases of conversion, that is data migration and activities after migration. So let's now go to this data migration folder. Okay, and now let's try to understand, when we are saying data migration, what kind of data do we need to migrate? Do we need to migrate our customers, vendors? Do we need to migrate our master data in system conversion? What do you think? When we are doing system conversion, is it like the customers and vendors are not already created? Or those are already created? If I ask you, what are the master data that you normally move from the legacy system to any SAP system? What are the different kind of master data that we normally migrate during the implementation?
GL master data, vendor, customer master data, asset master.
Right. Cost center.
Cost center master data.
Yes. Activity. Yeah, exactly. Cost center, profit center, activity types, GL accounts, cost elements, customers, vendors. These are all the master data. But do you think that master data migration is required? Because is it like they are not created already? Are not GLs already created in your source system? When you are doing the system conversion, the master data is already created in your ECC system, right? So do we need to create it again?
No, we just need to migrate through the mapping of the table, and then it will come from the existing system to the new system.
Exactly. So we don't need to migrate the data of GL, cost center, profit centers, not at all, because those things are already available in the same system where you are working. Then why this data migration is required? This data migration is only required that if you, in SAP S/4HANA, there are new tables available. Now let's take a simple example. In ECC, you have a GL account and cost elements at two separate master data, and there was no account type field. Okay, but in S/4HANA, the way in which you create a GL account, there is a difference. Cost element and GL account has been merged together. Right. Now, if they are merged together, then definitely we need to migrate that to the new system. Right. And that is exactly what you do when you are migrating the data. Data from the old tables will move to the new tables. Wherever there is any change in the functionality, if there is any change in the master data, from the old system, the data will be automatically copied to the new system. So you don't need to do the Excel upload and all. See, whenever you do the data migration, normally if you are working on the new implementation project, what you normally do, you extract the data from the legacy system, maybe in Excel, through LSMWs, BDCs and all, right? But here, when we are talking about data migration, we are not saying from the old system, you need to migrate the data. The data is available already in the same system. It is just that it was available in some other component. Now it is being migrated to some other component. So within the same database, data was available in the old tables. You want to migrate to the new tables. Right. And that is the reason there is no need of LSMWs, BDCs in case of system conversion, because data is already available in the same system itself. Right. So that is exactly what we mean by the data migration. Master data, transactional data migration, but only from old tables to new tables. Nothing from scratch, nothing from out of the system. It is within the system we are migrating from one component to another component, or one table to another table. And again, these are all technical programs. Okay, so you don't need to provide any mappings. These mappings are automatically defined by the system. You just need to execute this program in a sequence, and automatically all the data which you have in your current ECC system in FI, that will be migrated to the new S/4HANA system. Right? Now, before you start, let's go through these activities one by one. Now, before you start the data migration activity, you can see this one where you are able to see this clock kind of thing. This is a program. But if it is just this one, this is just a documentation provided. Okay, system is not showing you the other details. It is just showing you the documentation which is provided. Just give me a minute. I'm getting some important call. Just give me a minute. Yeah, sorry. So I was telling you that before you go ahead and perform the configuration, not the configuration, sorry, configuration is already done. Before you start the data migration activity, there is this documentation available. And what this documentation is saying is, it is just helping you out in if there is any prerequisite to do this. Okay, so before you go ahead in this one, there is one documentation which is trying to tell you something. So let's go through this documentation. So it is related to partitioning of universal journal entry line item table. Can you tell me which table is this? Universal journal entry line item table.
AC doc,
right? AC doc A table is nothing but universal journal entry line items table. Now we are telling the same thing from day one, that there are many tables in SAP S/4HANA which are going to be deleted, which are available in ECC, and most of the data will get stored in AC doc A table. Now, if everything is going to be updated in AC doc A table, again, if you keep unnecessary data in AC doc A, your system will become slow, right? And that is the reason we want to make sure that only relevant data, only data which is very important, that should be available in table AC doc A. And again, this AC doc A, you can, in the database itself, you can create the partitions. See, now these things are technical. Okay, so I don't want you to understand what is partitioning and all. Just remember that since there is going to be huge data in AC doc A table, SAP recommends that you partition this table. Who will be doing these partitions? Your bases will be doing these partitions. So within the database, they will divide the table AC doc A into multiple partitions so that not all the load is coming to a single partition. Okay, and that is exactly what you mean by partitioning of universal journal entry line item table. To reduce the load, the main table AC doc A is getting divided into multiple partitions. So SAP has just provided some figures, like when you need the partition. What SAP is saying is, you need the partitions only if you are expecting more than 500 million records in your AC doc A table. Okay, or SAP recommends that if the records are between 300 million and 500 million, this is a partition size. Each partition size should be between 300 million to 500 million records. So let's take a simple example. Let's say you have 2,500 million or 1,000 records. So what SAP is recommending? SAP is recommending that if your records are more than 500, then there should be partition. So if you have 1,000 million records, you can create two partitions of 500 million each. Okay, but again, this will be taken care by basis. So just remember that what are the activities all about. It is not that each and every activity will be done by you. There will be a lot of involvement from basis whenever you are executing this operation. Right, so this is partitioning of universal journal entry line table, which has to be done only if there are more than 500 million records in the system. Now the question is, how will you know before you migrate, how will you know how many records will be there in the system? So this number you will get when you do the test migration. In the test migration, no need for partitioning, but when you are doing the actual production migration, at that time, if you find that in the test migration there were more than 500 million records, then you can maybe ask basis whether partitioning is required or not. Okay. Second is again the technical step. Regenerate CDS views and field mappings. We discussed this topic, CDS views. Can you tell me what are CDS views and can you give me some examples? CDS views or HANA views we discussed earlier. There are many tables which are deleted as tables, but they are available as views. Which are those tables which are deleted and are available as views? Okay, forget about all views. Can you tell me the tables which are deleted? Some tables which are deleted, I think we discussed this.
Yes, BS kind of table, BSIS, BSAS kind of table.
Right. We already agreed that these tables are removed. These tables are no more available. Yes. Okay. And if these tables are removed, what will happen is if I try to generate a report, if I try to execute a report in which the data is coming from BSIS and BSAS, that report will still work, right? That report will not tell you, I don't have data. It will not give you dump, or it will not give you no records found. Even if these tables are not available, they will still be able to show you the data. Why? Because these tables, whenever you ask any information from these tables, it will automatically go in the background and pick the data from ACDocA. And how this is possible? How system will automatically go and find the data from ACDocA? It is only because these tables were tables in ECC, but now they are converted to views. So CDS views are, these examples are the CDS views. Okay, and before you go ahead in the data migration part, system will create those views for you. So this is a step which is actually going to create, regenerate the CDS views and field mappings. So which field of BSIS is mapped to which field of ACDocA, that will be done in this particular step. Okay, so regenerate CDS views and field mappings will actually create those CDS views, which is again a technical step. Once this is done, you analyze the transactional data. Now, what is transactional data? Transactional data means you already have a lot of data in table B, say. You have a lot of table in ACDocA and ACDocT. You have a lot of data in BSAG as well as Faggle Flex T, Faggle Flex A. So Faggle Flex A, Faggle Flex T, these tables are no more available in S4HANA. They are replaced with ACDocA, right? So before system moves the data from Faggle Flex A, Faggle Flex T to ACDocA, it will perform the check that whether the data available in Faggle Flex A and Faggle Flex T, is it consistent? Is it consistent means, are they reconciled? If the data it's in ECC itself, if it is not reconciled, let's say there is a difference between FI balances and asset accounting balances. So if the data already is not reconciled in ECC, how can you expect that their data will become reconciled in S4HANA? Right? So system will perform this check, whether it will check whether the data is already reconciled in your current system or not. If it is not, system will not allow you to proceed. You have to first reconcile your existing data in ECC system, right? So this is an activity which will verify that whatever data is available in your current system, is it reconciled or not? Okay, so here you will execute it. It will be executed in the background. It will take 1, 2, 3 hours based on how much data you are trying to analyze. And in order to see the status, whether it is completed or not, you can go to the display status. It will show you whether that activity has been finished or not, if there is any error, like the normal background job. Okay. Then you have this documentation. If you open this, this is just a documentation. There is no program. Why? If you go to 1503, 1511, even 1610 system, till 1511, right, which were the previous versions of SAP S4HANA, all these activities were manual. So you had to execute this one by one. But now SAP has provided this new program, Start and Monitor Data Migration. So if you execute this program, automatically in the background, these activities will get performed one by one. So in 1503 and 1511, for each of this activity, there was a separate program. So first program we were executing to migration of cost element. What do you mean by migration of cost element? So all the cost elements which are created as primary or secondary cost elements in ECC, they will become GL automatically, right? Because secondary cost elements in ECC, we don't have the GLs. So when you execute this migration of cost elements, system will automatically convert your cost elements to the GL accounts. Similarly, it will again verify whether the data is reconciled or not. For material ledger related data, it will automatically copy the data from ECC for the traditional valuation tables to material ledger valuation tables. It will migrate the line items, it will migrate the balances, and finally, it will also automatically calculate the depreciation based on new asset accounting. So if you go through 1503 and 1511, all these programs are manual. Now, there is only one program which will do all these things for you at once. That is start and monitor data migration. Step by step, all these activities will be performed. Okay, any question till now? See, these activities are straightforward. Okay, so you just need to understand what is the purpose of each and every activity. But you actually don't need to do anything. When you execute, let's say for example, if I execute this start and monitor, you don't need to provide anything here. You just need to click on execute and it will give you the report. It may take time because it depends upon how much data you are migrating. But you can see currently there is no migration activities because the client is empty. Why? Because this system that we are using is not a migrated system. This is already installed as S/4HANA system. But when you have ECC system and you are performing the system conversion, then it will give you the complete details, like how many migrations you executed, what is the status currently. Okay, so this program, you don't need to provide anything. This is just execute and system will automatically execute. It will take 2, 3, 4 hours, it depends. So each and every program can take minimum 15, 20 minutes to maximum 4, 5, 6 hours also. Okay, so it depends upon how much data you have. And in order to make it simple, what SAP recommends is make sure you have minimum data in your source system. Now, how will you make sure that? So let's say in ECC, which you are trying to migrate, you have 10 years of data in that ECC system. So what SAP recommends is if you go ahead with that 10 years of data, each and every activity in the data migration will take hours. So instead of migrating the complete data, you should archive the 8 years of data and only 2 years of data should be remaining in ECC. Again, this is just a recommendation. Okay, we are not saying only 2 years of data can be migrated. Let customer decide whether they want to migrate 2 years, 3 years, 4 years of data. But more the data, system will definitely take more time in the conversion. And that is the reason there will be more downtime. See, customer will always say, I want to migrate all the data. But if you tell him that then it will require more downtime, then definitely he will not agree because he don't want to stop the system for weeks. He want to make sure that only in 2, 3 days, entire data is migrated, right? Normally in the weekends. So in order to keep the system conversion, like, it should take less time. You need to make sure that the data is limited. Instead of migrating all 10 years of data, SAP always recommends that you archive the data which you don't need in a S/4HANA system and only take the data which is required. Okay, any question till now? Okay. No questions. So this will migrate your GL balances, material ledger and everything. Then you have this migrate general ledger allocations. Now, what are allocations? So in one of the topic that we are going to cover in CO, we already discussed activity types and statistical key figures in our last session, right? Why we are creating activity types and statistical key figures? Because we want to allocate the prices or we want to allocate the balances of a particular cost center to some other cost center. So how these balances are determined currently? Can you tell me which are the balance tables in SAP ECC? Which are the total tables in SAP ECC? Total table, very simple.
Fagel Flexi.
Right, no, Fagel Flexa is a line item table. Fagel Flexi is a total table, right? So whenever you do these allocations, system will always pick the data from Fagel Flexi. But now since in S/4HANA, Fagel FlexT is no more available. So instead of picking the data from Fagel FlexT, system will go and pick the data from AC.T. AC.T. Now what is AC.T? T is for totals. Okay, but don't worry, this T is not a table. It is a view. Okay, so ultimately data is coming from AC.A. So if you just read this documentation, it will tell you the same thing that in ECC, the allocation data was coming from table Fagel FlexT, but now the data will come from AC.T view. Okay, what do you mean by view? View means ultimately if you go to this AC.T, it will also pick the data from AC.A and perform the summarization at the time of reporting. right? So just remember three tables. This is not AC doc is not the only table. AC doc means accounting document. And then there are three different tables. So you have AC doc, which is nothing but accounting document, which is common. Then you have AC doc A. Okay, this is not a table. This is just the full form I have written. There is no table called as AC doc. Table is AC doc A, which is actual values. Okay, what are the postings which are coming from FR? You have AC doc P, which is nothing but planned values. So this is also the table. Planned value is the table. And then you have AC doc T. Not going to store any data. This is a view. Ultimately, data is coming from AC doc A only. Right. So earlier this Faggle flex T was used. Now AC doc T would be used. So that change we are doing using this program. This program will change your allocation cycles. Instead of Faggle flex T, it will pick the data from AC doc T. Then you have this migrate of house bank accounts, which I told you this is one topic which we are going to discuss in regarding the house banks. Okay, so skip this as of now. Then you have trade finance, which I told you this is related to MMSD credit we discussed. And then you have this complete migration. Okay, so these are the only activities that you need to perform to migrate the data. Your master data as well as transactional data will be migrated using the start and monitor data migration program. Okay, and for allocations, you have to execute this migrate general ledger allocation. So these are the only two important programs that are required in data migration. But before you use this program, as I told you, you cannot skip any step. You have to regenerate the CDS views so that the views are created. You have to analyze the data to check whether your data is consistent or not. If there is any problem in the data, is it reconciled or not? So all those things you do in analyze transactional data. Okay, and then in the complete migration, the last, again, this is not a program, this is just a documentation. So reconcile and compare the migrated data. So by this time, when you execute this start and monitor data migration, all the data from the old tables is already moved to the new tables. Make sure, let's say, once the migration is completed, see, you are using SAP ECC EHP 7. From where you SAP S/4HANA Finance 1809. Now, in this ECC EHP 7, there were already some balances, right? At the month end, whenever you executed this, there were already some balances. Now, these balances must match to S/4HANA 1809 balances, right? It should not happen that a customer in ECC, there was one customer in ECC, the balance was 1000 USD and it is showing 700 USD, which is wrong. So you want to make sure that whatever were the balances in EHP 7, those are same in 1809. And that is the reason SAP is asking you to compare the results before and after the migration. So even it provides you the list of reports that you should run before and after migration. So even before you start this migration process, SAP recommends that in ECC system, you execute all these reports, download those reports in Excel or maybe some other tool, okay, and keep it handy. Okay, because after the migration, how will you know whether your migration has been completed properly or not? Whether the data which was available in ECC is matching with S/4HANA or not, using these reports only. So these reports you will be executing before as well as after the migration. And you will check whether the data is same or not. If there is any inconsistency, then definitely there is some problem. Okay, so it should not happen. As I told you, my customer balance in ECC was 1000 USD and after I migrated, it became 700 USD, which is a complete big problem, right? It cannot be. You are converting the system. It should not change any of the figures for customers, vendors, and GLs. If it is creating the differences, then definitely there is something wrong. You have to check where exactly it went wrong. Okay, so you cannot say my migration was successful. There was definitely some problem due to which your migration was not successful, right? And once you are confirmed that yes, all my data is matching, only then you will go here and you will set migration to completed. You will tell the system, now my migration has been completed. There is nothing left. My migration process has been completed. Okay, so why you are telling the system set migration to completed? You are telling the system because once the migration has been completed, then again you cannot activate these activities. Okay, these activities can be executed only once. If your data migration is already completed, then again you're not going to execute all these things. You are telling the system, I'm already done with all these steps, and in this system my data has been migrated completely. Okay, and the last one is then activities after migration. So if I go to this Word document, we discuss what is preparation, we discuss what is installation, we discuss what is delta config, and now we discuss the migration of master data and transactional data. Now there are only few things which you need to do as a part of activities after migration. Okay, so what are those activities? Let's go and see in the folder. So activity after migration, you have transfer application indexes, which is again the technical activity. Okay, as a functional consultant, you don't need to, you just need to execute this. Okay, what it is going to do is, let me see. What are indexes? We discussed about the index tables, right? What are index tables? Can you tell me what are the index tables? Index tables, come on. First session we discussed, what are the index tables? There are two tables, two kind of tables which are not available in S/4HANA, which one is totals tables and second is index tables. Totals table example is Fagel Flex T. What is index table? You have this on the screen itself.
These are the index. Yes.
Yeah, these are called as index tables. Right, they are called as indexes. So now let me explain you what happens when you do the installation phase. Okay, little bit technical. When you perform this installation, what do you think? When these tables are deleted and they are converted to views, when is that is happening in the system? When AC Docker table will be available in this process? During the preparation phase, installation phase, delta config, data migration, or activities after migration? When can you see AC Docker table? After which phase can I go and see that new table is appearing now, AC Docker? Or in other ways, when can I go and see that old tables are deleted? Those are not available anymore, or they are converted to views. Just a guess, what do you think? In the delta config?
In data installation means after installation.
During installation, yes. Installation means what? Installation itself means you are deploying new functionalities. So when your technical basis team, they will install the new add-ons on the same ECC system, at that time itself, during the installation phase itself, index and aggregate tables are deleted, right? And they are converted to as views, right? But before system deletes this index and aggregate tables, what it will do is it will first create a backup. So backup is created for index and totals tables before they are deleted. So what is the coding logic of backup tables? So if I have BSIS as my main table, it creates BSIS_B. It will create BSIK underscore BCK. Right, so it will just suffix the purpose of this backup tables. The purpose, okay, why we create a backup? The whole purpose of backup is that if something goes wrong, at least I can get the data from backup tables. So same thing during the migration, system always create a backup table in the background. Okay, and that the purpose of the backup table is if something goes wrong during the conversion, at least we have the access to the backup tables and we can recover those things. But now, since you already confirmed that my reports are matching in this particular thing, when we said we completed the data migration and we said the migration to complete, this means now we are sure that everything has been matched, nothing went wrong, and we want to proceed. Right, so this means now these backup tables which were created, they are not very important, and that is the reason you are transferring those backup tables to hard disk. So currently, till the time we were doing this data migration, they were available on RAM. Okay, if you remember, I told you SAP HANA stores the data on RAM, but if you want to utilize the space, you what you can do is you can move the data from RAM to hard disk. So this transfer application indexes means moving the data, moving the backup tables from RAM to hard disk in order to improve the performance of the system. Okay, so if you just go through this document also. So in this customizing activity, you can transfer the application indexes, which means index tables, to the database cold area in order to reduce the main memory consumption. So instead of holding the data in the main memory, that is RAM, we are telling the system that move this data to hard disk to speed the process, right? So you execute this and this is the status. So when you execute this, it will work in the background and you can go here and check what is the status. Then you have filled due dates in FI document. Okay, before I talk about the due dates in FI documents, can you tell me, is it possible to, if I go to FBL1N and FBL5N, which is my vendor and customer line level reports, can I see the due dates there of the invoices? Is it possible to see the due dates in FBL5N and FBL1N report? What do you think? Is it possible?
Yes, I think possible.
It is possible, right? In FBL5N and FBL1N report, we can always see the net due date. Okay, what is the due date of that particular invoice? But can you tell me which is the table where I can get that information? Is there any table in SAP where I can go and see the net due date? Customer line level table, which is the customer line level table?
BSIK.
BSIK is for vendor, but okay. So BSIK is a table for vendor line items. Okay, vendor open line items. So in vendor open line items, do you have a due date column? Any idea? Do you have a due date column in this particular table? You will not be able to see the due date column here. Have you created any report? Anyone? Have you created any Z report in which you need to have one column as due date? Anytime, Akash, Mahesh, have you come across the situation where the customer has asked you, I want a report, the one column is due date column? Okay, Mahesh, have you worked on this kind of report?
Oh, go wrong.
Not. Okay. So if you are getting this requirement, Mahesh and Akash, so what happens is, if you have this kind of requirement where you want to create a Z report with the due date column, unfortunately, due date column is never available in SAP ECC. then you will come with the question, then how the system is showing in FBL5N and FBL3N. This data, the name column, is not coming from the table. It is coming from one of the functional module. There is a functional module which will ask you for the baseline date, and it will ask you for the payment term, and it will automatically calculate the due date. But it was never stored in any of the table. Due date was never stored in any of the table. Okay, and that is the reason during the creation of this Z reports, there was a problem. But now in SAP S/4HANA, the due date column has been added into the tables itself. Okay, so even in AC doc A, you'll be able to see the due date column. So in ECC, since there was no due date column, and now the due date column is available, so it has to be populated with the value, right? So if I posted some documents 2 years back, there was no due date column in that particular document. So in order to fill that due date into the older documents, you will be using this program. Very, very clear, like fill the due dates in the FI documents. So instead of calculating the due date with the functional module, if you execute this program, even your older documents where due date is not available already in the tables will get updated. Okay, so again, you have display offsetting account for filling of due date. So this is just the status information for this above activity. Then you have filled the offsetting account in FI documents. We already discussed what is offsetting account 2-3 times. I told you whenever you are doing any posting, any accounting posting, so you are debiting one GL and crediting one GL, at least. It can be multiple GLs also. So if I go to FBL 3N report, and if I want to see which was the debit entry when my GL account got credited, or vice versa, that is only possible if I have the offsetting account. So this offsetting account was also not possible in ECC. In ECC, there was no offsetting account column in FBL 3N, FBL 1N, and FBL 5N reports. There was a way by activation of one of the business transaction event, FIBF. Using that FIBF transaction, it was possible to derive the offsetting account, but it was not possible in the standard system, right? So now even this offsetting account is available. And again, whatever new documents you will post, system will automatically pick the offsetting account. But what about the older documents which were posted 2 years, 3 years back? So in order to fill the offsetting account column of those documents, you have to run this program. This will automatically bring the offsetting account in those documents. Okay. Then you have again the status, what exactly has happened. Then you have enrichment of balance carry forward. This is just, you have to execute as it is. This is just to make sure that the balance carried forward for the previous years has been carried out in the system. Okay, so this is from the technical perspective. You just execute each and every program in this in sequence. For balance sheet accounts, for profit and loss accounts, you are just carrying out the balance carry forward for the previous years. So this activity actually was not available in 1503 and 1511 also. They included this enrichment of balance carry forward now. Okay, just to make sure that each year's balance is carried forward properly. Then you have trade finance. You don't need to worry. Credit management, as I told you, this is something related to SD. I'll share this video with you. Accrual engine, we are also not worried about. And last one is deactivation of reconciliation ledger. So we discussed what is a reconciliation ledger earlier. I told you whenever you are doing any postings from CO to FI. So whenever you are posting something in CO as a secondary cost element, and you want the values should be triggered in FI, it was only possible through the reconciliation ledger. Okay, so for example, if you have two different company codes and you are doing the CO transaction, moving the cost from one cost center to another cost center. Cost center one belongs to company code one, and cost center two belongs to two reconciliation ledger. Component of FICO has been merged through universal journal. Even this particular thing is not required, and that is the reason you just have to come here and you have to say to the system that my reconciliation ledger is deactive, because there is no point, right? everything is one now. FI and CO is one. So there is no reason to have a reconciliation ledger anymore. Okay, so with this, once you complete this deactivation of a reconciliation ledger, your system is now ready to be handed over to the end users to perform the transactions. Okay, so for a few days, you will be monitoring whether the users are able to carry out their transactions, are they facing any error? But if there are no errors, then the successful migration has been completed. Okay, but as I told you, before you do this particular migration in your production system, there are at least 2 to 3 test cycles which you should carry out to check what kind of errors you are facing so that you are prepared well in advance for the production migration. There should not be any surprises when you are doing the production migration, because you will not get much time. Client will only give you 2 to 3 days. They will not ask you, let's say you are stuck and you are asking for 5 days to close the issue. Customer will be definitely frustrated because he is not able to carry out his day-to-day transactions if you are in middle of the conversion. So whatever errors are coming, you need to identify those errors. You need to solve those errors before the production migration. Okay, and there are many places where you are getting the error, but you will not get the answer why this error is coming. And only thing is you need to approach SAP. During the implementation or support project, there is a very strong role of SAP also. Every time, whenever you are getting the error, you need to report it to SAP if there is no proper SAP note provided till now. Okay. Any questions?
Gaurav, one question. For example, if company code is set to complete, we cannot move any kind of data back from we cannot move data back, right? Once it is done, it is done. Or do we
complete? Which one you are talking about?
Set to complete. The option which you have. Yes.
Yes.
So once a company code is set to complete, yes, set migration to complete. We cannot.
Pooja, it is not company code. It is not company code.
Okay.
Yes, and you cannot, definitely you cannot go back. If once you see, when you are saying my migration is complete, when you already identified, you already compared the results. If my results are fine, then definitely why will you go back?
Yes, okay.
Okay, so I'm not saying it is not possible, but it is not very easy. There are a lot of issues that you will face if you say migration is completed and then you want to change something. Because each and every activity, as I told you, it has to be performed in a sequence. You cannot just go to here and then you realize, oh, I missed this one. You have to make sure that each and every activity is completed in the sequence.
Okay, Gaurav.
Okay, Mahesh, Akash, any questions?
No, Gaurav. No.
Okay. So this was about migration, and now we are just left with the overview to cache management and IBP, where we will also understand the way in which we need to create a house bank and all. Okay, so I think this should be enough. You just go through all these videos you are getting next 2-3 days. Go through at least the conversion part, because other part is very easy. Whatever we discuss from the new implementation perspective, I think that is not a big thing. We already when you practice on the system, you will be able to understand each and everything. But since this conversion part, you will not be able to practically perform in the system, the understanding is very important. Okay, you have to understand, just remember this main points. What are the different phases? What is done in the each phase? Why the preparation phase? What happens in the installation phase? So just go through these things in detail.